So I have had the pleasure of doing some incredible things, and these are things that I got to do. I did get to fly the F-15, F-16, and F-22. And although that was truly incredible, I got to go places, meet people, and see things that I never otherwise thought I would ever get the opportunity to do, to include meeting heads of states from foreign countries, to sitting in the Oval Office with President George W. Bush, to a boy from Greenville, Alabama, ending up on the 10 million boxes of Frosted Flakes. That was something I never had to envision. It wasn't because I was this great individual. But I want to share with the steps and the reason I believe that I got the opportunity to do some of these great things. Now, I was actually raised in the church. I grew up going to church. I was very blessed for that. And prayer early in my life was really something that was more mechanical. It was something we did before meals. It was something that I did every night before bed, but there wasn't much meat to it and wasn't much context to it. And certainly I said prayer before we took communion every week. And quite frankly, I had what I describe as Superman syndrome. Things had fallen in line for me. They had seemed to go real well. And my plan was I was going to play baseball as long as I could. And I was having a very successful career, talking to professional scouts, invited to go to professional tryouts. Hey, I was just going to pick what city I wanted to live in and who I wanted to play ball for. And things were kind of falling in place. And quite frankly, I didn't think there was anything that was too big for me to accomplish. I believed that if I had a dream and I wanted to do it bad enough and was willing to work hard enough, I could control the outcome. And quite frankly, I don't know if any of y'all suffer from that, but I saw a commercial recently that kind of described what I was as a child.
Sometimes people need help asking for help.
Righty tighty.
That's not coming off.
Hey, Tim, pickle jar stuck again.
And so I did not like to ask for help. I wanted to figure it out myself. I wanted to create the solution, and I wanted to get to the end game. What I did not realize was right here where James talks about God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. And although I didn't verbalize my pride a lot, I did have a prideful mind and a prideful heart. And so, as often does, one of my great proverbs, not my great proverbs, but a proverb that I use regularly is pride goes before destruction and a hearty heart comes before the fall. And so as things went easy and I still had this prideful heart and I thought it was going to be up to me to control the results, as often does, a fall came. And so as my baseball career began to deteriorate and I went from being one of the star athletes to starting to sit on the bench and starting to watch scouts walk past me and talk to my teammates, that was something I had to deal with and very confusing. And what was I doing different? I was still working harder than I ever had been before, but I was getting different results and not understanding the complexity of that. I began to make bad grades. I made my first and my last F in college, but I was struggling. And that was something that grades had never been a problem for me. But things were starting to fall apart and deteriorate. And then every relationship that I pursued fell apart for various reasons or another. And so as things started to deteriorate, it occurred to me that I had to reframe my mindset and what I was doing. And although I had been praying throughout my years and going through college, I found out as I reflected upon myself that I was actually praying for the prize. I was praying for, God, I want to go play baseball here. God, I really like this girl. I hope this relationship works out. Can you just make her the person that I need her to be, so that we can be a couple? And so I was praying for the wrong things, and it occurred to me that I need to pray for wisdom and discernment. And I not only needed to pray for that, I needed to pray for God to show me what he wanted me to become, to put the right people in my life and to lead me and to let his will be the ultimate goal, not my personal will and desires in this life. And I can tell you, God's timing is amazing. Within 6 months of me having that epiphany and starting to pray differently, and my baseball career was deteriorating, somebody said, you need to go talk to the ROTC folks at the university I was at. And so I went over there, talked to them. I said, hey, I've been interested in flying. And they said, hey, if you score what we think you're going to score on the Air Force officer's qualifying test, I think we'll have you a pilot slot within 6 months. And I did, and they ended up having me a pilot slot in 3 months. My dad was also a good motivator and also used my own psychology against me. And, you know, Dad said, son, you got a better chance of being a professional baseball player than you do becoming a fighter pilot. He said over 50% of the people that go to pilot training wash out. And I said, Dad, you're absolutely right. 50% do wash out. I plan on being in the other 50%. And so still a little bit of pride, but that was more confidence than arrogance. I can also tell you that as I had been making bad choices throughout life of who I wanted to pursue and who I wanted to spend time with, I prayed for this young lady before I ever met her. I prayed that God would give me a godly woman who would be a loving and faithful wife, who would be a fantastic mother and a great partner to go through life with. I met her within 6 months, and within the next year, I graduated with honors and was commissioned the same day as a second lieutenant in the United States Air Force. And then 1 week later, I married that young lady. So now we get married and go off for a 30-year career. We had no idea it was going to be a 30-year career. We were going to try this Air Force thing and see where God led us and wanted us to be. And so 30 years comes with a lot of challenges throughout that time, one of which is 17 moves. So we have moved our family 17 times across this great United States and across the world. We actually lived in Japan for 5 years straight with our kids. But I can tell you, Leslie actually has PTSD from packing tape, the sound of packing tape. If you've ever moved, when she hears that, she starts trembling and is shaking. But prayer was such an important part of our life, to go through the 17 times where you're going to uproot your family, your friends, your church family, your kids. Every time we did, Leslie and I were very fervent in our prayer that our kids would be surrounded and make new friends that would help them feel welcome in that community, that would be good influences on their lives, that Leslie and I would have that same network, and we'd find our church home. And it was amazing, almost every time during 17 moves, you know, prior to the move, it was 2 weeks of that, Dad, you're ruining our lives. To 2 weeks after that, that was the greatest thing that has ever happened to us, is move to this new community, make these new friends. And God continued to put folks in our lives to support us and influence us. And many of you know actually the Lockwood families. So Leslie and I met Scott and Kelly Lockwood, who the Lockwood ladies, the three girls played soccer here, put them in our lives at my very first assignment at pilot training, where I was a student pilot and Scott, their dad, was an instructor there. And they have been just great members of the church, great friends and great mentors to both Leslie and I. Now, while I got to do a couple of great things, cool things, one thing that we didn't plan on was Leslie being a single parent for a lot of that time. So although, you know, flying as a Thunderbird was pretty neat, oftentimes I was out sitting either in the Oval Office or meeting the heads of state, and Leslie was at home raising two kids. So I actually left her when our first daughter was 5 months old, was my first combat tour, and so left Leslie and went into combat for that. I left her with a four-year-old and a six-day-old the second time. And then lastly, the third time was towards the end of my career, where I went to Baghdad for a year. Lots of prayers throughout all of those times, through times of separation when I was on the Thunderbirds or various combats, employments. And I can tell you lots of prayers when I was in Baghdad for a year with it being rocket and mortar attacked over 130 times. There was many days that Leslie woke up, usually about every other day, that Leslie woke up with a simple text that said, I'm okay. She knew something had happened, and she knew I just didn't want her to hear about it in the news when we lost people. But, you know, after a 30-year career and having been blessed, you know, we figured the world is our oyster. But the thing I wanted to do is I wanted to be purposeful. I wanted to do meaning and purposeful work. I didn't want to pursue the money. I didn't want to pursue the lofty places by titles. We wanted to go where God led us. And so I convinced Leslie we're going to buy this fifth wheel, and we're going to take about 4 months. She calls it the great exhale from the 30-year military career. But we are just going to travel to see our beautiful country and spend some time together, you know, and be prayerful and listen to see what God wants us to do. If I'm in the woods, in the water, that's my happy place. That's where I feel closest to God a lot of times. So at least 1,000-acre ranch up in Colorado and chased elk and mule deer with my bow for 5 months. And Leslie hiked and biked all over Colorado. You know, and it's just so majestic to watch the sunrise and have your quiet time with the sunrise coming up over the Rockies. And we got really close to God and really prayerful. And I said, I'm gonna go back and read the Bible again, cover to cover. And so I did that throughout our what I said was going to be a 3 or 4 month journey turned into a 17 month journey. So I was a little procrastinating. I was enjoying our time together so much. But I went back to reading the Bible cover to cover, being prayerful each and every day. And I will tell you that the day I finished the Bible, I got an offer to bring us back home to Alabama. And this was such a blessing. Leslie's mom is the only one that we have living. Still. And so for Leslie to come back and be able to be a caregiver for her mother was something that was very important for us. I'm blessed to have my brother here, my sister, my brother Bill here, my sister Rachel Hartzell's up in Prattville. We're surrounded by our friends and family. Leslie's sister Vicki is here. But to have that opportunity, we were convinced that was God's plan, is for us to go home during this chapter of our lives. And we did. Thought I had the last job that I was ever going to need. I was going to do that till we retired, and chased grandchildren all over the country for the rest of the time. And we were cruising. And all of a sudden, I walk into office to work one day on a Tuesday, and my position was dissolved that day. No notice. No explanation, no notice. And we walked away. And that was really confusing for us, you know. And so we're struggling with the thoughts. We'd bought a house. What do we do? Do we sell the house? Are we going to have to move again? And we talked about it, and we said, we're going to continue to be prayerful. God's provided for us each and every time of our lives. We're going to have faith that he's going to do something amazing with us, and through his protection and provision, that God is going to lead us where he wants to. Now, I put Tuesday up there for a reason. So I want you to imagine my position is dissolved on a Tuesday. At church that Sunday, I talked to a friend of mine. And I've explained to him what has happened, this, that, and the other. We have a good conversation, and he goes, "Do you know President Henry out of Faulkner University?" And I said, "No, had never met him. I know some of the family, but I never had the opportunity to meet him." He said, "You're going to talk to him this week." And I'll tell you, President Henry called me that week. We went down to a Waffle House, had breakfast together, got to meet each other. And President Henry offered me a position that was not, that currently did not exist at Faulkner University, come here. And it was such a blessing, but there's such affirmation there because we were prayerful, because we were diligent. Sometimes God works fast, you know. It was confusing for us. Why did he send us to that other opportunity? It was to allow the timing and conditions. I mean, that position wasn't available here at Faulkner. It didn't even exist at Faulkner. And God needed that time for the conditions to be right. For us to come here, and we are very blessed here. But my whole flying career, I got to think of years ago, my whole flying career, I brief, execute, and debrief each and every time I touched an airplane. And so I said, you know what, that needs to be part, I need, God needs to be that important to me, that I brief, execute throughout the day, and then debrief. So I started making my mornings is my brief time with God. I go read the Bible. I pray about the events of that day, at least what I think is going to occur, that I'll have a godly mind, godly spirit throughout that day. And then throughout the day, I'll pray various times, and that helps cages me. You know, there's a lot of things where you're going to go, today's going to be a great day, you know, and somebody cuts you off or has road rage and it makes you react and you start losing. You were set up for a good day and that day can start to deteriorate and get away from you. So this allows me to recenter throughout the day, much like an athlete, you know, does in between the quarters or in the halftime. Throughout the day, I continue to make prayer part of my life. And then at night, I take time to reflect of how I did that day. You know, were my actions godly? Would God be proud of how I acted today, how I responded? And many times I'm asking forgiveness for where I fell short, for where I did not, you know, speak with a loving heart or didn't have the patience that I should have. And a lot of times, and every time, I'm giving him thanks for his blessings that continue to overflow. And I can tell you, as Tim Tebow there, you know, humble yourselves, therefore, into the mighty hand of God so that he had the proper time may exalt you, casting your anxieties on him because he cares for you. And I tell you, it took me a long time to understand and quite frankly, develop the difference between confidence and arrogance. And I can tell you whether you're flying 18 inches away from five other airplanes or you're strapping on a $140 million jet to go into combat, that you better be confident about your abilities and the capabilities with that aircraft. But arrogance will get you or your wingman killed. And that's something that I tried to remind and instill in everybody is there's a great difference and you need to be confident in your ability and confident that God hears you and knows you. Now, while I'm proud of the things that I got to do, what I'm most proud of is who I am. And who I am, first and foremost, I'm a child of God, but I get to be a husband to this woman, and I'm not looking at her for a reason. And if you ever have to speak in public, I'll encourage you not to, or look at the shoes, one of the two, but don't make eye contact. I've been blessed to be husband to Leslie for 33 years, and she has blessed us with two amazing daughters who both married their high school sweethearts, and I have two son-in-laws that I couldn't be more proud of. They're a great godly man, and we have a loving family. And this little fellow hung the moon. This is Abner James. This is our first grandson. This is also the first time the males have outnumbered the females in my house. And we just found out a few weeks ago, number two's on the way. Y'all, what I want you to understand is ability to draw near to God, is using prayer in your life and creating moments in your life and habit patterns that put prayer in your life, not a mechanical prayer. God doesn't need to know what your hopes and desires are. He doesn't need to know what your dreams are. He already knows, but he's looking for you to humble yourself, to go to him and ask him to lead and let his desires lead your way in your life. So I wanted to share with you today, and if you're struggling with anything, relationships, addictions, family members, schoolwork, anxiety about jobs, use that opportunity. Use that opportunity to connect to God in prayer. Just ask for his wisdom and discernment and fruits of the Spirit to lead you. And if you don't need help with anything, first and foremost, go give grace or thanks for God's blessings. Ask him to be a blessing to those that are around you, because many of folks that are sitting next to you maybe struggle with one of these other areas of their life where they need your support. They just need an ear or a shoulder to hear them. They can pray with them. And so that's a great opportunity to connect to God through prayer. Now, this was my comeback to the original hype music, that this might be the first time that words of Van Halen have ever been used during a devotional, but that song right now from Van Halen says, right here, right now, let's turn this thing around. And so what I want to share with you is today, if you're struggling with anything after chapel is over here, if you want somebody to pray with you, come up here. We'll go behind the curtain. I'll pray with you. There's lots of faculty and staff here that will be helpful to pray with you, or grab one of your friends or teammates and grab a moment to connect to God and draw close with him so that he can draw close with you.